Finally, we have the flag of Swaziland. And tonight, Rav Natty mentioned something very interesting that I didn't know. His father actually designed the flag. So this magnificent, beautiful flag is being designed by none other than Rav Natty's father. So I'd like to introduce our very special guest, Rav Natty Gametsi, who traveled with his wife, Shana Golda, all the way from Tzfat, to be with us tonight. And Inkosinati, I don't pronounce it correctly, Inkosinati Gametsi was one of eight children born in Swaziland. His grandfather, as far as it is known, is the longest reigning monarch in all time, King Sabuza II of Swaziland. He ruled for 82 years and 254 days. He died in 82. Inkosinati was educated in private schools, both in Swaziland and England. He went on to earn his honours at Oxford University. He returned to South Africa and in 1987 received his master's degree at this university, majoring in German, French and Italian. The following year, he was appointed by the Supreme Court of South Africa as the official German translator. And he achieved all this during the time of apartheid, which is actually quite remarkable. He's fluent in 14 languages. Half of them are European, including Yiddish, and the other half are African languages. In an Italian literature class, at Wits, he noticed somebody writing from the right to left. And he thought this is very interesting. He found out that the language that they were writing was Hebrew, and he decided that he also wants to learn this, so he enrolled in the Hebrew department at Wits. Now, this was led to introduction to Professor Moshe Sharon. He's here this evening with his wife, Julie. Professor Moshe Sharon had established the Center for Jewish Studies at Wits and was head of the department. He invited Inkosinati to come to Jerusalem to study for a doctorate in Hebrew language. This invitation played a pivotal role in Inkosinati's life, as we will see tonight. From Moshe and Julie Sharon, they just celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary and last week the marriage of the granddaughter. So from all of us, we wish you a huge mazel tov. Mazel and bracha. It is indeed a great honor and a privilege to call on Rabbi Natan Gametsi. He will relate his incredible story and his journey of an African prince who became a rabbi. Thank you very much.
Okay, at least give me a chance to practice my English here. Yeah, it's very nice. Because, you know, all this Hebrew, you know, that's all we speak nowadays. Okay, first of all, you know, we all know that Hakarat HaTov is a very important thing, you know. If people are not grateful, you don't really want to help people that are not grateful, right? So obviously, the first Hakarat HaTov I gave is to the Ribono Shel Olam, who brought me in this journey. After that comes Mishpacha Sharon, because without him I wouldn't be here. You know, it's very interesting, you know, there was somebody that here in Israel we call him the bulldozer. Who is that? Arik Sharon. But there's another Sharon who's a bulldozer now. His name is Moshe Sharon. He basically tried to change all of my slavery sheets so I could get here. Did incredible things. I thought it was impossible. It was going to give up. No, no, we're not giving up. We're going to get a scratch. We're going to go to Telfed. We're going to go through Zionist Federation. Then Davinia Street. We're going to help. We're going to get this thing, this thing. You know, I mean, I was just totally amazed. And, you know, obviously when I came here, I was alone. But I can't say I didn't have a family. Mishpacha Shalom is my family. I was a bit invited over there. Whenever I want to come in. Whenever, sometimes during the week I come for dinner. And sometimes when I didn't come for Shabbat, their son, Yonatan, would come to my apartment in French and No, not Shabbat. You know, I mean, okay, there's someone that I do miss, or something that I do miss, and that's a certain dog called Socks. Right? One of their dog they had many, many years ago. And what a certain thing that Professor Sharon used to prepare, Harib, we call it mustard pizza. We prepare this type of soup type thing, all kinds of ingredients. You see me in the kitchen making mustard pizza. And, Eshet Chayil, Rosh Sharon, Judy. Well, you know, that's the one thing I always thought, when would I be publicly able to thank the Sharons for all they did for me? And Hashem organized it. Here we are today. I see he's still a young man. We've grown older, we've grown old, great, but he's still a young man, go for Hashem. Okay. So, Les already said a few things. I think where I can start, you see, there's so many things in life, you know. Thank you very much, Liz. You know, I remember back in Johannesburg. I don't know how many of these people are still with us today. Friends of ours who loved Chazalis. Oh, South African Jews love Chazalis. Who was that professor of pathology? What is his? I don't know if he's still with us. What was his name? He was a professor in sorry? Yeah. I forget what his last name was. Charles Isaacs. We used to sing together Chazones and Glenn Hazel. It was fantastic.
Do you remember when I asked you if other students know Chazones like you? What did you say to me?
I don't know. What did I say?
Vosva is a chazer fin lokshav.
Vosva is a chazer fin lokshav. I remember. Okay, so to me, just to see Mishpacha Sharon again, that's already dayenu. It's worth the whole trip from Tzfat, it's worth the whole the Gansazah. Okay. So I think when you look at my journey that has been described in short by Les Glassman, and you see where I am today as a rabbi, I think one of the things that was driving me right from day one, even when I was a child in Swaziland, was search for truth. Not me, truth. Because my way of thinking that if something is true, you have to do it. Right? That's how I got to Judaism. That's why I'm a religious person. Because to me, if you see something is true, then do it then. I see truth as something obligatory, not something that will I can, will I know. That's why I'm the way I am. So, I like drama sometimes. So when I went to study Hebrew at the Hebrew University, I mean, who was studying Hebrew? Only Jewish people. I mean, who else? I mean, even the Jews hardly speak to themselves. So what's this black guy coming? The time of apartheid to come and study Hebrew. What's he doing? I couldn't care less. I walk in there. So, they gave everybody over there, everybody had to have like a Hebrew name, or a Yiddish name, something. So all of them were Jews, anyway they had Hebrew names. And I remember when I started to study Hebrew, a certain Mrs. Grover, she actually met Aliyah. I don't even know if she's still with us. She was really an older lady. She passed away. Okay, anyway, she was my first Hebrew teacher, Mrs. Grover. I actually met at the Hebrew University when I was studying there. And I saw her just entering into, I was in the library at the Halat Sofit. I said, Nati.
Wow.
Now, the whole thing is this. So the name that I chose, I simply translated my name, Kosi Nati, into Hebrew. So when they asked what my name is, I said, Emmanuel. Because that's what it means. It means the Lord is with us, and Kosi Nati means God is with us. So Emmanuel. Okay? So that was my name when I was learning Hebrew, they knew me as Emmanuel, Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Now, I'm going to do a quick, because this Emmanuel thing is very important. After not being in South Africa for 16 years, I was invited by Rav Shmuel Mofsen, who knew me in my days at Vitz. He heard I was a rabbi teaching in Tzfat and this and that. He said, oh, why don't you come over to the area? I want you to speak in Johannesburg, Cape Town, give lectures, Pretoria, different places. So I accepted the invitation. I had not met my family for 16 years. And you'll soon see if they show anything, a clip, footage of my late father. That's the last time I was in Southern Africa is when my father passed away about 10 years ago. So I went with my wife. He passed away in Johannesburg. He went to buried in Swaziland. Most of my family now lives in Johannesburg. Very few, no one of my direct family lives in Swaziland anymore. But anyway, one thing that was said that I did not know. He talked about how he knew he'd have four horsemen. In other words, the first children are going to be four boys. And then girls come after that. This, by the way, is my place of birth. It's called Hlatikhulu, which means like a big forest. And most of the time we lived in Mbabane, over there, which is the capital. So, what my dad said is that since he knew that he's going to have four boys, he even gave them names before he saw them. He already gave them names. And then, when he saw my mom, he said, okay, this is his name, this is his name. So I'm the last of the four boys. He said, he also gave me a name. But before he entered, you know how Christians speak, right? So, before he entered, he said, God spoke to him, says, no, I'm the one giving him the name. His name is Emmanuel. I started crying, because that's the name I was just translating. I didn't know that I was born with that name. Imagine, when I was already in my 40s, and now I know that I was born with that name. But my dad belonged to a type of Christianity where this name is reserved for Yoshka, this name. So he was embarrassed to call me Emmanuel. So he translated Emmanuel into Sisuzulu, Nkosi Nati. And then, when I was at Vitz, I didn't know that. I just translated my name, Nkosi Nati, into Hebrew, not knowing that that name was the one I was born with. Imagine. So that was like something. So I asked my dad, I said, Dad, what name did you want to give me? He said, no, I can't do that. Once God has spoken, I'm afraid, I can't tell you. So I never really knew what name he wanted to give me. He said he's afraid of God already, you know? So already I understand, obviously looking back, why Judaism was so important to me. You know? Obviously at first I didn't know, you see. The thing is, my journey to Judaism is about a journey of the soul, going back home. To me, Judaism is very, very familiar. So when I was at Vitz, and we had language laboratory sessions, in those days we had an Israeli instructor helping us with the pronunciation of texts, and the first text we get, you know, I was listening to this cassette, and the background was like Yemenite music, very nice, you know, reminiscent of camels in the desert, you know? And I was relaxing there in my seat. All of a sudden, I said, wait, there's someone speaking. What was he saying? He said, Vayi yachad hadaveri ma'ele, veloki nisayat Abraham vayomer elav, Abraham, vayomer hineni, vayomer kachna et bilcha et yechitcha asher hafta et yitzchak, velech lecha al eretz amoriya, va'aleu sham le'ola, al achad yarim asher omar lech. I thought, what's going on here? Now, it's very difficult to give over emotion, right? Because what one person's emotional about, the other person, for him it's nothing. What the other guy is emotional about, the other guy thinks it's nothing, right? People are different in that way. But in order to do justice to this occasion, I have to try and convey what was going on with me when I heard that Akedat Yitzchak. As you know, Swazis are very traditional. You see, when that person went to change his clothing to go and see the prime minister, it's because he's wearing his formal clothing now. Now he's wearing his best. But the Swazi king, barefoot, mahia, no problem. They're very, very proud of their culture. Very proud. Swazi TV, everyone dresses like that. You know? So, the whole thing people who are, I'm sure that the ex-ambassador to Swazi knows about this. Swazis, you see, have certain different dances for different occasions. The most well-known one in the world is probably in Ntwala, where these maidens, where the king traditionally chooses a new wife every year.
Well, does he keep the old ones too, or not?
Yeah, well, first of all, he has to know who they are. I'm saying, anyway, so me and my dad would always go to these occasions, you see. When I was in, was King Sobhuza, before the present king. And there'd be dancing and this and that. So everyone who goes there, all the princes there, know these dances off by heart, but they're very intricate because with all the different occasions, right? So, the only way I can describe how I felt with Akedat Yitzchak is, let's say one of these princes would lose his memory. Lose his memory, doesn't even know he's a prince, he doesn't know where he comes from, doesn't know anything. So, what happens? One of his brothers comes, trying to revive his memory. So what does the brother do? He goes through some of the paces of these dancers. And lo and behold, the person who does it says, how come I know this? Yes, you move this way, and now you do this way. How do you? So when I came across it, I said, I know this thing. I know it. How come? Lo and behold. Familiar territory. To me, becoming Jewish was coming into my own element, not foreign element. To me, Judaism is who I am. I am a Jew. That's basically the best way to describe me. I don't even know how to better describe my own self. So, to me, it was very emotional because I always knew that I was different from my siblings. Right? And the journey of being Jewish is about the rahmanis that a Kodesh Baruch Hu had on his people, whoever they were. Even if they're Swazi princes, he couldn't care less. He wants them back. That's what kibbutz galuyot's about. So, I'll tell you something, you know. The first time when I left Matsapa Airport in Swaziland, to go to Jan Smuts, it was then Jan Smuts Airport in South Africa. When I left, I did not look back. Something in me told me, says, you know, you're not coming back here. You're finished. This is a, in other words, it's a pace, a place in my life that I knew is finished, and now I'm starting a new stage in life. Right? To me, it was very surprising when I all of a sudden get hazmana to go back after so many years. What's going on? That place, it still exists. I mean, me, I'm all Israel focused. I don't like leaving the country unless I really have to. The only thing I like about leaving Israel is coming back to it. That's my favorite part. So, interesting, Les mentioned something. Whoa, no, who was the person who spoke first?
Doron
mentioned Parshat Vayetzeh. I don't know if it's going to be shown on whatever they're going to show up here, but when my documentary was made, the people from South Africa who were doing it, they wanted me to learn a little with my ex-chavruta who lives in Harlem, I think he's still around, Rav Tzvi Maoz. And you know what we were learning? Vayetze. And we're talking about when the tzaddik leaves the place, is the rakes are rushing. And now I see, what's going on over here? Is he saying that just because he knows? I mean, what's the deal? See, everything is beshert, you know? Hashem is in charge, malasot. I wish I was in charge, but I'm not, malasot. So, I suppose I'm more emotional than I thought I would. I suppose it's Moshe Sharon's fault. I blame him, because it's my bad luck that I like him so much. Malasot. He told me once he came to Swaziland, and he was caught speeding. He was so excited, he caught someone jumping around and very happy, you know, because he didn't catch anyone before. So, I don't know, you know, I hardly ever come to Yerushalayim. I hardly ever leave Tzfat, let alone come to Yerushalayim. Right? I'm hardly ever out of Tzfat. But obviously, Yerushalayim is Yerushalayim. Can't say it's not. Or Rosh El Olam, for sure. And I'm very grateful to be in the city. The holiest city on earth, no one can deny that. That's why everybody's fighting about it. So, that is also, for me, it's a big shechiyahu, the fact that I'm even in Yerushalayim, where my journey started. So I want to tell a certain part, because I want to leave certain things. It's such a long and there's different facets to these things. I want to say a few things, and then perhaps, if Les would do that, maybe I'll take a few questions, because this is such a multifaceted story. It's basically about Shnei Hafachim, two opposites, bringing two opposites together. Like, there's so many different facets of my life that you hardly can think that it's one person who went through all these experiences. Right? Very few people, most people don't really change that much from the way they were born. It takes, now we know why a Gil Tzedek is called Ben Avraham, because he does that type of journey. He just leaves everything and then says, no, I'm going. You know, when Professor Sharon invited me to come to study for a PhD in Hebrew University, I looked at him and I said, what's going on here? Israel, why with this camels and heat and desert? What's going on? What am I going to do with it? I go to places like Europe, England, that time. Russia's such a primitive place with flies and who knows what. Often when I came here, I realized it wasn't like that. But what was going on in my mind when he suggested Israel even? I was thinking of Lech Lecha. Lech Lecha me'artzacha u'miladetcha u'mibet avicha el ha'aretz asher ara'eka. I said, okay, I'm coming. But I knew that for me, coming to Israel, I was following, I wanted the Kodesh Baruch Hu. I always wanted the Kodesh Baruch Hu. That's why at Vitzpah I had so many Jewish friends. And in those days in apartheid, it was not the damn thing for a black person to be friendly with white people. I remember once, you know, on Friday, after university, many of us, with friends and mine, we'd go for a few beers at the Bozzoli pavilion, where all the rugby fields were down there. So there's one black friend of mine, he's also visited Israel. He told me, he said, you know, there's the head of the Black Student Society at this. And he says, he went to this person, ask Nati why he's so friendly with these white guys. And when he said that, I said, what white guys are you talking about? Me, Jews? Well, Jews are Jews. I mean, what are you talking about? I didn't even know what he's talking about.
And obviously, when I come to Israel, I see Jews of all kinds of color.
To me, I knew Jewish is about being Jewish. It's got nothing to do with color at all. And that's one of the reasons why I felt very much, very comfortable with the Sharon family. I mean, people like Yuval Sharon, Yonatan, Michal, these were like my family, and Gushi Amit, you know, Avigail and Avital. These were my family. I remember, you know, Judy Sharon, that her daughter Avital used to have to take certain classes in town, a certain place I even forget. And when she couldn't do, say, okay, Nati, you go and take her over there, wait for her and take her and bring her back home. Imagine. That's how much I was a member of the family. So hence, I couldn't control my emotions when I saw them, obviously. I'm glad to see that, you know, Baruch Hashem. And I obviously also knew Judy's mom. Now, very, very proper English, you know. As well as the Howards, you know, the dentist, and Meshulam, and the rest of the children, you know. Unfortunately, I didn't have time to meet Judy's father before he passed on. And I think he went to Chutz La'aretz and then came back, but somehow it didn't work out. But I knew her mother very well. So, basically, I cannot say my life has been easy. I can't say such a thing. But one thing I can say is my devotion to truth. Because to me, truth beats everything. If you suffer, you suffer. If you suffer less, suffer more. Beside that, but at least you follow truth. Because I'm not a person who's about comfort zones. I'm about following truth. I've got my eldest brother's a multimillionaire. You probably see him in the video. He's an action. He goes all over the world, and he's got so much money. But to me, I was prepared to forfeit everything just for truth alone. To me, it's an absolute value. And perhaps I can open the floor here, and then we can sort of guide the conversation. I don't know when you want to show that, but I'd like to open the floor. Maybe some people can ask some questions, and I would that way make sure that I cover more ground, that people get more or less what they want to hear.
Can I just say something?
I should always hold it close to you. Okay,
fine. Nati mentioned about the video. So a few years ago, I was in Joburg, and it was on a Sunday, and I was watching SABC, which there isn't much to watch, but I came picture of Nati. I said, well, I know that guy. Anyway, it was a whole program when Nati went back to Swaziland, and it was incredible. And they interviewed the principals, and it showed Nati's family and the interviews. Prof. Sharon's on there, Prof. Kadoza's on there. It was amazing. So I phoned SABC. I really wanted to get a copy of this video. I must have spent about 3/4 of an hour trying to convince them why I wanted to buy it, but it didn't work out. And I gave up. And I thought, you know, I know the people in the video. From Osamer, from Chabad. So I asked them who produced the video, and they told me, I think her name is Marion Siegel.
That's correct.
So I went to her home in Sandton. She's got kids living in Telstow. And I bought, in those days, it was a VHS. You know, remember these VHS boxes for all us old fogies, I think. Anyway, so I bought the VHS, and with Nati's permission, we converted it to a DVD. And I had a patient who worked for IBA Israel Television, which doesn't exist anymore. But I gave him the DVD with Nati's permission, and it took about a year, but IBA negotiated with SABC, and they bought the rights for the video. And it has been shown on Israeli television with Hebrew subtitles. They normally show it around Shavuos time. It's the most amazing video. It is on YouTube. I checked last night, it's there, the whole video. We have it here. But I think it's more interesting that we've got the real person here that we can ask questions. The video you can see anytime. It is on YouTube. And this evening's talk will also go to YouTube. But it's a fascinating story, your journey back to Swaziland, meeting your parents, your family. And I really recommend you all to see it.
What's the name? Is it getting on YouTube?
I think the journey, well...
Google him on YouTube and you'll...
If you put
my name,
Rabbi Natan Gametzi, it will come up.
Natan, that will come up.
Yeah, Natan Gametzi. The journey of, I think it is the journey of an African prince to Judaism. Okay, so we're gonna open up the floor for questions.
I'll answer with the microphone. I can. Can everyone hear me when I speak now?
It's better with the microphone.
Okay.
Okay. Should I?
I'd like to know.
I don't know if it's going all the way.
He can repeat the question.
Okay.
Yeah. I'd like to know what type of religious upbringing you had as a child.
I'll. Okay.
In terms of.
The question is, what type of religious upbringing did you have as a child?
Well, I come from a very Christian family, more like evangelical type, and my mother, on both sides, my family is very Christian on both sides, right? And that's what, unless you're asking what made me make the change.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Because you have the Old Testament and the New Testament.
Correct.
And so I was wondering whether you had a particular liking or attraction to the Old Testament? Or
I don't know if I'll say that. I think what happened was when I was introduced to Lashon HaKodesh. That's why I talked about hearing the Akidat Tzara. To me, what I try to convey is that becoming Jewish to me was not changing. It was coming home. To me, that's all it is. It's not about changing. Right? So I remember once I was tricked a little day. Somebody, South African radio, whatever it is, they said they wanted to talk to me, interview me live. So I agreed, said, why not? So then I saw the person was started showing, oh, so you Swazi royal family, this and this. I said, yes, yes, you've done your research. But I knew there's something going on here. And then all of a sudden he comes to me and says, yeah, but why did you change from becoming a Christian to becoming a Jew? You know what I said to him? I said, look, I said, why did you move from one chair to go to another chair? You know what I said to him? I said, look, first of all, it's only one chair. Not true. I said, look, if you, let's say you have a leaking roof, the roof is leaking, right? So you call a plumber, but is the plumber, let's say he just does a sponge. I've cleaned up the mess now, pay me a few hundred shit. What about the actual thing up there? So I said, my journey to Judaism, I'm just going for the source of things. I want to see the beginning, where it comes from. I'm not happy in the middle. Where is this thing coming from? For me, there's such a thing which they call in Hebrew, Bikusha Emet. To me, that's an absolute. I'm not happy halfway. No. I have to go to the truth. And that's why I'm a Jew. Because this is who I am anyway. It's like when I talk about my father with my name, to me it was a shame saying, no, this guy is one of my guys. He's one of my people.
The video is on YouTube, is African, wait a second, African becomes Orthodox Rabbi, conversion of Judaism, January 24, 2013, it's on there, 46 minutes.
Graphic Ashman from Jerusalem Post.
Rabbi, when you came to Israel, even white people had a hard time getting converted.
Getting right, what?
Converted. Yes.
I mean, even if you believe that you came home,
yeah.
In other people's eyes, you're a convert.
So, same thing. What
did you experience in terms of difficulty of being accepted for returning to your faith, if you want to call it that?
Difficulty?
Did you all hear the question?
No.
Okay. Even a white person in Israel has difficulty in converting. So Greer asked the question, what difficulties did you have in converting here in Israel? Which is it's a good question.
If you want the truth, none. You see, when I went, there's something very, when I decided I was going to be Jewish, I was going through a certain identity crisis, because I felt part of the Jewish people, but I wasn't really halakhically a Jew. And I didn't know what to do with that. You know what I did? I said, oh, I was angry with Hashem. I said, why am I not Jewish? What's the matter? So what I did, I said, okay, I'm going to go to the most Christian place in the world. Let's see what the Kodesh Baruch Hu is going to do. So where did I went? Go, went to Rome, Italy. Went to Rome. I said, ah, only now to our shop. How Christian can you get? You know, over there, people with their crosses, nuns. It's the Christian national over there. So my hotel room was right next to St. Peter's Basilica. And the street going on into St. Peter's, I was sat having a cup of coffee there. I looked at the street sign in Italian and said, La strada dell'Immacolata Concezione, which means the street of Immaculate Conception. Oh, wow. How Christian can you get? God had a baby, Mazel Tov, Mazel Tov. I've made this in Shona. So I said, boy, you're after a shop. So I went into St. Peter's. With that, you can buy everything in the world. It's actually priceless stuff. So I thought about Italian stuff and all this. And then there's one Italian tour guide helping people along and speaking in Italian. So they talk about the Roman Empire and this is what they did for civilization and this and that. And when he was talking, because obviously I speak Italian too, and I was thinking, well, I was thinking, what were the Jewish people going through during those periods of history? I said, well, there were the Crusades, Inquisition, open the face, people be burnt at the stake just for being Jewish. Just because they wanted to remain Jews. They didn't want to trouble anyone. I thought, well, I have got a problem because I wasn't being Jewish. Look at what these people did for their Jews. They were prepared to die just like that, with the worst torture you can even think of. When I saw that the way I was thinking, I said, look, my friend, even when you come to the most non-Jewish place in the world, you still want Judaism. Because you know that this is what you're about. I went back to my hotel room for the first time in my life. I said, Shema Yisrael. I felt such a big core. I was so emotional. It was huge. I said, okay, fine. I'm going back to Israel. This is nonsense. So I came like Erev Sukkot. And people, you know, Meshavim, Bain Lulav, and all this and that. So I'm still answering that question. I haven't, but it's, the answer to it is not so as simple as. So the whole thing is, I already knew when I was coming back, I'm coming to convert. So the family friend of the Sharons, I used to sit next to him in shul sometimes when I go to Midbar Sinai, the Ross family. Him and I used to sometimes be a guest as well for them for meals. And since I knew him pretty well, and he knew that I was coming to show that I was interested in Judaism, he always knew that. So I went to speak to him in his home. I told him, you know, Rabbi, I want to convert to Judaism now. And he said, well, there is somebody I know who may be able to help you. I said, who's that? He said, Rabbi Kadoza at Osamech. So I went to speak with Rabbi Kadoza. And we started learning what I could learn as a non-Jew, you know, a bit of Tanakh. But when the time came, there's something which sometimes I half believe, sometimes don't believe. And it was the Mashgiach at Or Sameach says that even though they were not allowed to teach me Gemara, Torah Sheva Alpe, he says, I looked at it myself and I understood. I remember once I was at the Sharons, you know, so they had this Gemara Beitza. So I was just looking, you know, Beitza Shinodah, Yom Tov, blah, blah, blah. I was looking at that, and then I started reading the Gemara. And then I started laughing. And Yonatan Sharon said, what's so funny? He said, How come they read my mind? They know what I'm thinking. This book, what kind of a book is this? They know what I'm thinking. Get into my head. And then afterwards, I was very close to the late Rav Simcha Wasserman. That's all. He said, yes, the Gemara is just a big brain. You know, if you're asking the questions that the Gemara is asking, you mean you're thinking straight there? Like many times when a person is learning Gemara, and the rabbi says, oh, ma'ata Gemara yetish alenze. The Gemara is going to ask, just wait. You understand? It's chewing over, chewing over. Anyway, the story is like this. The reason I believe the Mashgiach is only in retrospect, because when I went to the Bet Din, here in Ohol Kosh, they asked me, why do you want to convert to Judaism? Don't you understand the Jewish people hate them, and they kill them, and give there's always trouble for the Jews. We're surrounded by enemies that always want to wipe us out. Why are you looking for this? You know what I say? I said, you know, it's very interesting, Rabbi. The Gemara in Yavamot that talks about Habali Gayel, that you're asking this question. And I remember because I had read that Gemara in the Yeshiva. So I said, it's very good. And if he says, Eini Kedai Mekabel Oto, they all look like that. And then I said, look, I'll tell you, the reason why I want to be Jewish, I said, I'll show you Tehillim Ayin Gimel, the end. Va'ani Kirvat Elokim Lito. I said, I just want to be close to Hashem. Come on. That's all I want. And I know the Jewish people are the ones that are closest to God, and I want that. The very first day that I went to the Dayanim, here in the Chof Kodesh, was the day of my conversion. One meeting, it was okay, let's get the Hatafat Dam and the Mikveh, let's get the stuff over with already. No trouble at all. One day. Right? Because I also didn't expect it otherwise. Because I always said, I'm just coming home, for heaven's sake. A person's not allowed to go home. Why, all of you want to go home at the end of the day, no? You say, no, yeah, sure. Why, if someone wants to say, no, Mark, baby dog. What God, Mark, baby dog. Obviously not. So, obviously, we all know that there are people in the society that have racial prejudice. You can't say it's not true. But coming from South Africa, this was nothing. I mean, there are people who kill you for your kind. I mean, yes, nothing. Even if a person's causing you kushi, but Aval met paro navo, that means it. What's the big deal? Right? I never, you know, if you're surrounded by primitive people, in Malasov, so that's it. To me, conversion to Judaism was like a piece of cake. Piece of cake. So, thank you. Thank you.
Sally had a question.
I just want to ask you, what was the reaction of your family? The Swazis are a very traditional people.
Correct.
And I remember visiting the king. I forget which king it was, but it
must have been Sokhuza the second.
Probably. So yeah. We went in, the tradition and the whole reception was incredible. So what was especially your father and the reaction of your family to you becoming Jewish?
Okay, did you all hear the question?
Yeah.
Okay, what was the reaction? Because Swaziland is a very traditional country and the people have tremendous traditions. So what was the reaction of your family when they heard that you wanted to become Jewish?
It's that chill.
Well, that's a very interesting question because when I knew that I was going to be Jewish, I didn't tell anyone. Because I thought, they're not going to want me to become Jewish. But am I going to listen? No. So why am I asking for permission when I'm not going to listen anyway? Right? Because to me, God comes first. I mean, I would never be at peace if I didn't convert to Judaism. It's out of the question. So, they got to know in the by and by. Because what happened was, over at, where I was at Osameach, where I started off, there were also South African Jews who knew of me when I was back in Johannesburg. So, by word of mouth, my family also got to know that at a certain stage I converted to Judaism. And they were pretty upset with it. And we weren't in contact, as I said, for 60 years. As far as I'm concerned, what that's about is this. With me, I felt, look, if Hashem can take care of 3 million Jews in the desert for 40 years, one Jew is not going to make too much of a difference. Why not? And I'm pretty thin, like you can see. I mean, I don't take so much days. I don't eat that much. You can feed one more. I did not wait for any reaction because I knew that I was going to do this anyway. For myself, that closeness to Hashem, I wasn't prepared for anyone to stand in the way. After that, the question. That's why I can't say my life has been easy, but it has been meaningful. I just want the truth. Once I have the truth, I'm finished. That's all. Yes.
You mentioned a couple of times the truth.
Yeah.
And how did you get to the notion that Judaism could have been the truth compared to your initial faith? Could your initial faith have been the truth also?
Okay, did you manage to hear?
Repeat it.
No. Okay, the question was, how did you know that Judaism was the truth?
His initial religion could have been the truth.
Yeah, how did you know that your initial religion that you were brought up was the truth and that Judaism was the truth?
Well, I think to answer that question, I have to say that when it comes to, first of all, I knew that I belonged to Judaism. In other words, it's not so much in Gemara talk, we talk about la apuke the havamina. In other words, what have I left thought? What am I thinking now? From havamina to maskana. But the way it was for me was just that, look, I mean, I don't know if they're Christians here, I don't know if they're faint people. But to me, it just wasn't the truth. That's all. It's not like I had anything wrong with it. But in other words, with me, there's something built in, a homing device of the truth, a homing device, and nothing can help. You know? And, you know, that's just the way I'm made. I know with people it sounds strange because, you know, with me, I didn't have a problem. In other words, I knew that when I find the truth, I'll know it. And nobody has to tell me that it's true. Huh? When I came across to you, I said, yeah, okay, this is it. This is it. And Christianity never meant anything anyway, right? To me. You know, that's what I'm trying to say, is that many people do not move so much from what they were brought up. But I travel continents, and I move from left to right. And that's really what I'm about, that I just zoomed into Judaism because something inside of me knew that it was the truth. That's why when my father told me this story about Emmanuel, it really struck home. Because he was telling that, no, God already decided you're one of his guys. You're one of his people. And to me, it's obvious. To me, my family are the Jewish people. That's my family. You know, I mean, I don't see what the whole big mice is. I don't see what the big shtick is about. The guy just coming home, for heaven's sake. Amen. As soon as I left at the bike, let me go. Okay.
Okay.
When did Emmanuel become Nata?
First of all, you have to understand.
Okay. Sorry, the question. When did you change the name from Emmanuel to Nata?
First of all, like I said, I didn't change from Emmanuel. Because I only realized it was my name, the Mafia. My parents never told me, because they were ashamed of having such a Christian, Yoshka type of name. Because there's certain people, like certain type of Protestants, that you can't give that to their child, because that's the name for the person they believe in. Right? So, I learned only afterwards. So, the thing is, when I chose a name, they'd always call me Nati, right? That's also, my Ngozi Nati people call me Nati, also in South Africa. So I went to the bed then, and yeah, Nati short for Nata. I said, Nata, is that good? I wish it was more dramatic than that, but it wasn't.
In the halakhic process, sometimes the rabbis forsake truth for halakhic clarity. Not so concerned with the truth, but will choose something to be kosher, mutter, heter, verse, instead of following truth. Does that bother you?
I don't even understand the question you're telling me.
Sorry, could you just repeat it? You said that they...
In the halakhic process, the rabbis will forsake truth for halakhic clarity.
For example, that's a very controversial statement.
When you have a mixture of kosher meat and non-kosher meat,
yes.
We know for a fact that there is non-kosher meat in the mixture. Yes. But as long as there's rov kosher meat, we don't care that the truth, the essence of reality, that there's non-kosher meat. We will have.
I think, you don't want batel b'shishim.
That's an example of choosing.
I understand.
Truth.
That's the way you interpret it. Okay, fine. But the thing is this. The whole thing is this. When you say batel b'shishim, like the example you use, the whole thing is. That is the very thing. They're all like, if you use that example, there's all the thing like a b'riya, that it doesn't matter. It's the afilu be'elef lo batel. Depends on you. You see, with me, when it comes to halakha, that's how it decides that this is done. This is how we do it. You see, I don't see that there's a contradiction between halakha and truth. I don't see such a thing. And I've studied these things for many years. You see, the thing is this. Many people, I suppose what's made difficult for many Jews is halakha, because it tells you what to do and how to think. And most people say, no, I'm a chacham atzmi. Yeah? Halakha clarifies how you look at the situation and how you walk. Why do you think halakha? This is how a Jew walks. This is how he behaves. You see, I, in a way, don't like free will. Why? Because I know that at the end of the day, Hashem is totally in charge. So if you see that earlier, it's much, much better. Many people have a problem with Orthodox Judaism because it tells you exactly what to do. How to wash yourself, how to put on your shoes, and everything is conducted through halakha. I'm a person who knows that if a person is really close to God, there is no way to move. No way. And I'm quite happy with that because at least things are clear. If I was in charge, I'd be very much afraid because I'm not God. I'm glad he's the Balabas. All I have to do is follow what he says. That's it. So, I don't know how to answer this question.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Rabbi Natia, today's a big day in Southern African history. Mugabe finally...
Oh yeah, Mugabe is an old man.
He finally stepped down. But we still have Zuma in South Africa. I'm sure we'd be interested to know, how do you see the situation in South Africa, and especially for the Jews there?
Okay, I'm just going to, for all of you, this is Steve Lindy, editor of Jerusalem Post and our Jerusalem Report. Another wonderful question. Today, my wife comes from Zimbabwe. Today, Mugabe, after independence, Mugabe had to stand down. I think he did. But how do you feel and your reaction to South Africa and the problems with the president and all the corruption? And what is your outlook on South Africa and what's happening there today?
Well, first of all, let me start that when I left South Africa in the mid-'80s, I thought, what, there is going to be a bloodbath over here, man. They're going to hack each other to death. Huh? And I'm surprised. I was like, no. All of a sudden, I was in Israel already. All of a sudden, Mandela's getting out of jail. But people forgot about the club. Without him, you'd never get out of jail. Right? And the party could have basically gone on forever. And it was a very, very wealthy country. Even though separate amenities, they could still, that economy was very strong. Obviously, it's not the truth now, is it? The rand is very, very weak now. If a person counts the shekels, he's a rich man over there. Right? So, the thing is this. I was watching. I went to a certain school in Swaziland called Waterford. Maybe they're going to show a bit of footage there. And I know some of Mandela's children. I mean, Zinzi, one of them was married to one of the princes in Swaziland. I think they got divorced, but Zeni and Zinzi, daughters of Mandela, I knew them very well. Right? But now, and then after that there was Thabo Mbeki. By the time, I was in South Africa, it happened to be there for the inauguration of the chief rabbi, Warren Goldstein. I was invited there with other dignitaries and other rabbis in Johannesburg. I just happened to be there because I was doing talking there. And after Thabo Mbeki, then comes Zuma. The thing is this. One thing that I know, if you look at Africa in general, Africans are tribal people. They are not nationalistically oriented. They are tribally oriented. And that's one of the things that people from a Western look, they don't understand that. For example, one black person from another tribe might as well be Chinese. You see? For them, they only care about their tribe. What do you think happens in Swaziland? They only care about the Dlamini's. They couldn't care less. That's why all the people with education all left. They all left. They went to South Africa, they went overseas. They wouldn't stay there. Huh? And now what's happening in South Africa, let's see when the next president will be a non-Zulu. Okay, the first two were Xhosas. But we also know that there were highly educated people, right? Xhosas, but Zulus are for sure the majority when it comes to the numbers. And now you have him marrying quite a few wives too. Simply African Zulu tradition. So that's what it's about. So now he's a Zulu. What's, he cares about Zulus. So the Xhosas, okay, but say that, but they're not going to beat the Zulus. You know, I don't think you'll ever get a real democracy in South Africa. Because it's just not going to work. This is just a downward spiral. It doesn't get better. It doesn't get better. My advice to South African Jews is to come home, you know.
Shama was in Sinai. I hope mine was there as well as yours was there. But what did you find uncomfortable in your childhood? I know what made you comfortable in Yiddishkeit, but what made you uncomfortable in your childhood in your environment?
Okay. Did you hear that? You all heard it? It's quite lovely. What made you uncomfortable in your own childhood? Or was there anything that made you uncomfortable in your own childhood?
Well, you see, I felt that, you know, it's not so much about feeling uncomfortable in childhood. I've always been much more of a cerebral person than, physically oriented. So, I remember we had a big house in Mbabane, you know, and in the summer, we keep the windows open, get fresh air. I was the youngest of the boys. I have a brother who's just a bit older than me. He doesn't appear in the video. And he was very, very active physically. He was rushing around the house. And I looked at him, you know, and I said, well, if he runs around like that, he's going to hurt himself in the window. Sure enough, a few minutes later, ow, 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 ow. I thought, oh, I'm a fool. I didn't see that coming. What's the problem here? So that's the whole thing. I mean, because how I look at life is about meaning, truth. Because the whole thing is this. It's not that I had a problem with Christianity as such. Because I know very little about it. Because it never really interested me. But one thing I do know, stand the way people live, right? To me, I was always puzzled. Like, let's say normal, secular people, you know, you go to school, finish school, go to university, get some profession, maybe dentistry, whatever you do, and then you get married, you build a family, and the children grow up, and then the parents become grandparents, and then they pass on, and the next generation becomes grandparents. I was looking at this, you know, I said, yeah, but what's the point? Shema. You know? Because to me, you know, some people are like they're standing on an escalator. So there you are standing there. As we know, with escalator, you just stand in the same place, and then you're all of a sudden at the top, right? So I was thinking, life is like that, you know? 10 years old, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, boom, finished. Okay, so what is the point then? That's why I tell you that I'm not comfort-oriented. Because my whole thing is, this is stupid. Because let's face it, the person gets up in the morning, say, okay, you see him, he's getting into his car. He says, well, where are you going? I'm going to work. Why are you going to work? Well, I need to feed my children, I need to support my family. That's it. Okay. Why are you eating? Well, you know, I need to, so that my body functions, I need to eat, you know? Okay, then why are you going to sleep? Well, you know, in order that I wake up refreshed, then, you know, he's got answers to these things. These things are obvious and there's answers to them. So the funny thing is, okay, but how about the world and creation? I don't know, this is just the way it is, you know? Yafeh! So for the small things, there's reasons. The biggest of things, ain't sit on the car. I said, this is really stupid thinking. Right? I said, I don't think like that. So that was the whole thing. It wasn't so much moving from Christianity or that, it was simply finding what I'm here to do. Absolutely. And as far as I'm concerned, I already found it. What?
Okay, we're going to take two more questions. Aaron?
Thank you. Natan, I want to thank you for your inspiring words. I had an opportunity to visit Swaziland from Washington, D.C. in the early 80s, and we'll talk about that more later. Can you tell us a little bit about your work and your mission today, in Swat, out of Swat? What do you see as Jewish mission to the world, to the nations?
Okay. The question, very nice question, Aaron. What do you see as, well, what are you doing in Swat? What type of work do you do, and how do you... how do you recruit people? Do you are you a community rabbi? Do you give lectures? What are you doing to improve the situation of possibly Judaism here in Israel?
Well, first of all, I basically talk about Judaism. Talk about many people who come to Sfat. All over Israel, they know me as Hanasich, Ahine Hanasich, right? Especially in the Haredi world, they know me as Hanasich, right? So, the whole thing is this. Many times people, when they come to Tzfat, they say, oh, let's hear the Nasir, let's hear his story. Let's, you know, all types of yeshivot or seminaries that come. I basically sit and learn, that's what I do, right? So, when I give over my story, the many times that the Rosh Yeshivas or rabbis said, look, we know Rabbi Gamedze that you like to give Divrei Torah, but look, these boys here, they're not so interested. Just tell them your story, because they won't be interested in hearing anything more. Just speak for maybe half an hour, 40 minutes in the month. So there I go and I start speaking. And they don't, and then I start speaking. You see, with me, I cannot talk about my story without speaking about Judaism. How are you going to leave God out of the picture? I don't even know how to do that. I think it's a very clever trick if you can do it. So what happened is, when I've given over my, next thing, they don't leave, bichlal. Instead of 40 minutes, I stay for 2.5 hours. Nobody's leave. No, and even though they've been drinking lots of wine, they are listening to every word. The rabbi was so embarrassed because he realized that he was totally off the mark. He thinks that people are not really interested in hearing about God. They are. It's just the way you put it over. You know? You have to speak to the person in the shomer and he'll listen. You know? And then they came, the father, he said, okay, rabbi, will you just do what you know, right? No longer says, no, don't say it later. It's a long conversation. So, I also go to different parts of the world, invited, next Pesach, already together, we're going to South Africa, Johannesburg, and then to Platt, and I'm the officiating rabbi of the later for the Seders, and et cetera, et cetera. And in between, with my whole family, I'll be giving talks, and there. So that's what I do for a living. And, you know, one thing, when I converted and went to study yeshiva, I said, I am not leaving the world of Torah. To me, when I say Kihem Chayeni Ba'ol Kiyamin, I really mean it. This is who I am. Judaism and me, I don't see what the difference is. I don't see that I'm marrying opposites here. It's just about getting into your element and getting on with the job.
Incredible. I think you've said it all.
Okay, I just want some water though. Is this shit? I'm sorry about the Hebrew, but that's how I think, you see, Malasa.
I think on behalf of all of us, there really are no words to express our deep and sincere appreciation for a phenomenal talk. Not only a talk, for sharing your life with us and for giving us your time.
To remind them they can see the movie on YouTube.
Well, we really, really appreciate it from the bottom of our hearts.